First of all, I'd like to thank some people who are helping us immensely with this meeting today. The setup was done by Carol Amick, Janet Humphrey, and Bill Moonen. Our greeter today was Joan Jika, although Lee Borderer is sitting in her chair right now. Our bakers for the day, providing the cookies and so on, Lee Borderer, Catherine Shutkin, and Carol Amick. Our cleanup crew for today, Janet Humphrey, Carol Amick, and Bill Moonen. And our videographers from Bedford TV, who, as I recall, are Audrey, Arwin, and Noah. Although there may be one more person here. Is there? Nope. Okay, that's it. Audrey, Arwin, and Noah, and I'm very glad to have them here. Now, we do need people to sign up to do cleanup and setup and baking and so forth for the upcoming meetings in April and May. So I'm going to start this list around, and if you feel that you could do something like that, please sign up. Thank you. Our principal business thing today that we do need to talk about briefly and vote on has to do with the society's bylaws. This is a topic which I know is terribly exciting to all of you. And we have spent something over a year between about February of last year through roughly November and a little bit into January of this year rewriting ours. The text of the new ones has been placed up on our website for several months, and I hope that if you were interested, you took a look at them. They have been, I think, written very nicely. They have been approved by our legal counsel. They address a number of things that were just not there in the old bylaws, like indemnification of directors, officers, agents of various sorts, things like a slightly conflicting set of executive positions, one called the executive committee and one the board of directors, which we felt needed to get straightened out. So we've rewritten the bylaws. We provided the new text for you to review if you wanted to. And I will only say very briefly that the major changes were the old executive committee, which was the four officers of the corporation as a formal group separate from the board of directors, is gone. The officers are still there, but the old organizational bit called the executive committee is gone. The officers are elected now to be elected now by the board of directors, not by the members. You as the members will still get to vote on the directors come the May meeting. We made the number of directors on the board variable from 3 to 20, although the number we've currently got, which is 12, is a perfectly reasonable place to be in the middle. We took the detailed definition of committees out of the bylaws and set them aside. We defined four standing committees. The rest of them are ad hoc committees that will be created and will exist as needed. And I think with that, I'm going to just ask this group if there is a motion to accept the new bylaws as they were provided on the website for membership review. Second, been moved and seconded. If you are a member of the Bedford Historical Society, please vote by saying aye or nay. All the ayes for those who approve?
Aye.
Aye. Nays? Any abstentions? Okay, very good. I hereby declare that the new bylaws are in effect. And those of us who worked on the new ones, thank you very much. So with that, let's move on to our speaker of today. Our speaker today, Bob Frischman, has professionally repaired a large number of timepieces and sold many, many vintage ones. He's located in Andover, but he travels around doing all sorts of things related to horology and clocks and watches and timekeeping, as long as the device does not have a battery in it. And today he's here to speak to us, and I think without further ado, I will let him do so. He did suggest to me that I could put you to sleep with talk about bylaws before you even got here, and that he would prefer to put you to sleep himself, but I don't think that's going to happen. Bob, take it away.
Great, thank you.
I'll put your thing down there, sorry.
Okay, I'll bring it up. All right, can we turn the room lights off, please, so all these great pictures I've spent years accumulating will be better seen? Thank you. Well, thanks for having me. I'm amplified here, so I'm getting scared hearing my own voice, which usually I don't hear, but all right, I'll try not to knock the podium over either. So I'm in a, normally I don't do as many talks as I've been doing these days, but yours is 3 out of 4 this week that I'm doing. So I think I'm well oiled in doing these, but they've actually all been different talks too, because I have many subjects relating to horology, which is the science of timekeeping. And I do have a very esteemed colleague here in the second row, a good friend of mine, Richard Ketchin from Carlisle. So I probably won't be able to say anything now because I'll be afraid that I'm going to say something that he's going to have to correct me about later. But but I'm going to take a chance anyway. And if he jumps up pounding, you know, his cane on the floor, you'll know what all that's about. Obviously, this is the opening slide. And throughout this, you also will see some wonderful artistic images because, in fact, the talk I gave yesterday was one of my favorites, too, about horology and art, where I have a longstanding project of looking at fine art images going back 700 years to the beginning of mechanical timekeeping, where famous artists and not so famous artists show clocks and watches within the paintings. So at some point, too, I'd be happy to return and give you an art lecture as opposed to just one that's more specific about timekeeping here. So, and I'll talk about this painting more when we go along as well. So this is my front door in Andover, Bell Time Clock. So any of you are welcome to visit if you haven't had enough of me here already. My business name originated when I started doing clock repair more than 30 years ago by this illustration by Winslow Homer. And you may know that he was an illustrator before he was a fine art painter. And this is actually a view of mill workers in Lawrence, Massachusetts. And it's called Bell Time because the accompanying text talked about how already by this time, and in fact it had been centuries already, where people were more and more feeling like their lives were run and confined even by timekeeping. And certainly in Lawrence, Massachusetts, these textile mill workers, they had to start to work, they heard the bell, they had to get there by the second bell. If the third bell rang and they were outside of the gates, they didn't work that day. So already their lives were really being run by the clock, and I'm sure a lot of us, even retirees, sort of still feel like, you know, they have to, there's a lot of things they have to do when they have to do them, and some people sort of feel the tyranny of timekeeping based on that. This is Winslow Homer. I don't own that suit. I wish I did. It's a great looking one. But just to remind you of what that artist looked like. And if you want to visit his studio, where he lived the last couple of decades of his life, it's up on Prout's Neck, just south of Portland, Maine. And you can get tours of the studio through the Portland Art Museum. You can't just show up there. It's a residential area. But it shows the place where he lived and painted in the final 20 years of his life, even though he occasionally the winters drove him south. He usually said when the ice in the water bucket was more than 3 inches deep, he knew that it was time to leave Maine for a while because things were getting pretty chilly. Sometimes in more extended introductions, which I'm happy I didn't have to sit and listen to again because I already know who I am, but I will tell you that I'm also a liveryman of the Worshipful Company of Clockmakers. That's the Guild of Clockmakers founded, chartered in 1631 by King Charles I. And it's not automatic that you get admitted to the guild. There are still more than 100 occupational guilds in London that go even much farther back than our guild. But it gives me an opportunity to visit London and sit in these guild halls with giant portraits of the monarchs and feel like, you know, what am I doing here? But somehow they let me in, and I began as a freeman. I'm now a liveryman, and you can see me becoming a liveryman. We got to wear those robes for about 30 seconds and then took them off again. But there's the master of the Clockmakers Guild, that is now a good friend of mine, James Nye, who's welcoming me as a liveryman. And the liveryman now has many wonderful things that you can do as a liveryman. One of them is that once a year you can drive sheep across London Bridge. And I haven't done that yet, but I intend to try my hand at it. And that actually had a practical purpose, because many years ago, people with sheep and other animals would bring them into the city to sell for food. And they paid a stiff tariff on London Bridge by bringing the animals across the bridge. So it actually was quite a perk to be able to bring animals across without paying the toll. One of the other great benefits is that if you're drunk and disorderly within the city confines of London, the small city, you cannot be arrested. They just have to escort you home. So again, I haven't found out how well that works either. But the final one is really a good one, because if you commit a capital crime, you will be hanged by a silk scarf, not a hemp rope. So my wife always keeps that silk scarf handy, so that I'm ready to die, you know, in an appropriate way as a guild liveryman. So. Switching sides of the ocean, if we want to. I like to show photos of the Mayflower. We are talking about New England mostly here, and raise the issue of how many clocks and watches were on the Mayflower, and the answer is zero. The clocks and watches were expensive. They weren't particularly portable. People didn't have them unless you were nobility. And there would have been no reason to have one on the Mayflower. Here's an illustration. They didn't have photographs yet, but it was an illustration of people boarding the Mayflower on the other side of the ocean, and you see no one's got a grandfather clock on their shoulder. Clearly they were telling time in different ways, one of which was with sandglasses. And with sandglasses, obviously you don't know what time it is, but you know how much time has passed. And these were used on board ships, and even today the watches are still half hour, and the sandglasses were of half hour duration, and the helmsman would be steering the ship through the snow and the sleet, and he would turn it over when the half hour was complete. But sometimes there would be a problem called eating sand, where he was tired and cold and he would turn the sandglass over before the half hour was up. And if they kept doing that, especially in the dark or in foggy days, they could actually reverse day and night on the ship by cheating into that half hour every time too. But the sandglass would get turned over. This is a lovely Winslow Homer painting, so I take opportunities to show his artwork when I can. And of course, when the watches, if you have a Chelsea clock, for example, the watches, you'd know that every half hour, an increasing number of bell strikes up to 8, and then it starts over again. So the bells were rung too to alert everybody on the ship as far as what part of the watch you were in. And here they are signing the Mayflower Compact, Again, no watches, clocks visible on board the Mayflower. But what a lot of folks don't know is that the Mayflower Compact and the Mayflower itself were here in Provincetown Harbor for several weeks before they went on to Plymouth. They landed here first, and then they started to scout around perhaps for a better place because the Cape even then had too many fried clam places and all, and they didn't want to, and they needed to get away from all that. But this is Provincetown Harbor, and all those years ago, you would have seen the Mayflower at rest out there. And the reason they stopped when they did is they ran out of beer. And it wasn't just because they were, you know, enjoying beer. It's because the water, certainly, especially on a boat, was almost undrinkable and dangerous. But their supply of beer was exhausted. It took longer for them to get over. And they needed to find something to ferment. And they raided some Indian corn stashes and quickly made some beer that they could guzzle while they were looking around for a better place to stand. And also, as this marker says, in Provincetown, four of the people actually died right there. Four of the earliest, the Mayflower passengers, died right there in Provincetown, and they're being honored by this plaque that's there. In fact, the wife of Governor Bradford drowned, fell off the Mayflower and drowned right there on site. So this is my house, but no. Actually this is Salisbury Cathedral. And I show this because we're going back to England for a minute to talk about the origins of mechanical timekeeping, which eventually came here too. So one of the earliest known mechanical clocks that still is around is this clock movement that used to be in the tower of Salisbury Cathedral and is now parked down below and not doing any timekeeping anymore. But you can see these were large machines. They weren't clockmakers then. They were made by blacksmiths, mostly of iron parts. And they weren't particularly accurate, but it was a great symbol of technological advancement and a local sophistication if you could have a clock in the steeple of your church or in the town hall. So it was important and beginning in the early 1300s and perhaps even earlier. They say the mechanical timekeeping really started in northern Italy. There were monastic orders that needed to pray regularly at night. And before, you know, some poor monk was looking at a candle with light, with lines on it, watching it burn down and ringing the bell, or he was turning sand glasses over if he didn't fall asleep. But, you know, those kinds of orders needed to pray during the night at specific times. So the development of a ticking device that would keep track of time was important, and it was a great advance that helped a lot with that. And the word clock really derives from the Latin for bell, and these original clocks had no hands. They just rang bells at the time that would then alert the monks or the townspeople about what time it was. This is a more well-known clock. This is the day that Big Ben, the tower, the clock, was inaugurated in 1859, the first day that the clock started. But just so you can win the trivia quiz later on, Big Ben is actually not the name of the tower or the clock. It's the name of the bell that's inside there. So if you go to see Big Ben, you're not going to see Big Ben. You're only going to see the clock at Westminster and the tower unless you climb up there and with your earplugs, if it's on the hour, that you visit Big Ben that's in that tower. The arbiter, the argument settler for what time it was up until almost the 20th century were sundials, because the sun is up there, and as long as it's sunny, you're going to know what time it was if you put a stick in the ground or you have a sundial where the shadow actually travels around during the day. This is a lovely example that's in the garden at Beauport. That's one of Historic New England's house museums. It's in Gloucester. You can visit there. The house is beautiful, full of wonderful antiques and some clocks. But this is how people told time. This is how they set their watches and clocks until the late 1800s. So you needed a sundial to do that with. And sundials go way back. You know, they extend them all the way back to ancient Egypt, where somebody, you know, stuck a stick in the sand and saw the shadow moving and had the idea of using it as a timepiece. But this is a 4th century Roman mosaic, and you see that on the top is a sundial on top of this pillar. And the rough translation of this writing here is, "I'm late for lunch." And And this is, again, an early indication of already people felt tyrannized by timekeeping. They couldn't eat when they were hungry. They couldn't go to bed when they were tired. Oh, no, you know, lunch is when that shadow is on 12, you know, and we're not eating at 11:30. So, you know, again, already they were aware of these kinds of related issues. So this is not my mother. This is an early image of Pocahontas. And we're talking about a little south of New England history now. But the story normally that we all are familiar with is Pocahontas showed up and saved Captain John Smith from having his brains beaten out by the Indian chief. But that's actually not the sequence of events. Captain John Smith was carrying a little pocket sundial, and this was a little ball, like maybe the size of an orange, and he showed this to the Indians that were about to beat his brains out, and they all got very intrigued by, you know, what is this, and he was showing them how it works, and then Pocahontas came along and I guess saved him once they got sick of looking at the sundial. So just so now you know the whole story of Pocahontas, and there are you may know that there are many people who are descended from Pocahontas. She married John Rolfe in Virginia and had children. And there are very proud people who claim descent from Pocahontas, including this lovely woman, who was the second wife of Woodrow Wilson, Edith Wilson. If you don't believe me, there she is with Woodrow Wilson in a car. So I don't know if she looks like Pocahontas, but I guess there's a little bit of Pocahontas' genetic material in her. Another famous New England guy was Roger Williams. You may remember that he got booted out of Boston because his religious observances weren't quite corresponding with what the rest of the community felt they should do. So here he is showing up in Rhode Island and being greeted by the people that were very happy to see him coming and building some Starbucks and things down there. So, but the reason I mentioned Roger Williams is because we still have his pocket sundial, similar to the one that John Smith had. This is in the collection of the Rhode Island Historical Society. So they always have compasses associated with them. So as long as you point it the right way and the sun is shining and you get the shadow on there, you can tell, you know, accurately enough for those days. That it's what the local time was. So again, this is not me. This is somebody that you may recognize as Ben Franklin, and I mention him among his many accomplishments was designing the first currency, the first American currency. So he's showing. This was called the Fugio coin because you see the word here, the Latin, which stands for it flies. And he's trying to remind people that time flies. We need to get things done, you know, in an efficient way. And that's what this means down here too. Mind your business. He's not saying mind your own business. Don't be nosy. He's saying take care of business. We've got a war to win against the British. We've got an economy, a nation to build. And that's the motto which went on this design for the first currency. You see, it's dated 1776. It's the Fugio dollar. And he uses the iconography of a sundial because you see the sun is shining down on that sundial, which means, you know, let's work hard while the sun is shining because we have all this good stuff to do. This is Galileo. We've now jumped back across to Europe for a minute because he's important to the story because he was sitting in the cathedral in Pisa, and you see this is definitely Pisa because the church is slanted and that tower is straight up and down. So we know where we are. So he was sitting inside, and he noticed that that there was a lantern swinging on a long rope or chain from the ceiling. And he kind of had the idea that it was going back and forth at the same rate, no matter how wide the swing was. And he started to time it with his pulse. So obviously the sermon was boring, and he just needed something else to do. So he noticed that, again, no matter how wide it swung, that it kept the same period of oscillation. It went back and forth at the same rate. And he figured that this was a way you could apply a pendulum, something swinging to clocks. Because before, like in that old one we saw, it had a different system of ticking. It still ticked, but something was just clunking back and forth, and you couldn't really get very high accuracy with that. So he never built it, but there were drawings, and eventually the model was built, and this is what his first pendulum clock would have looked like. But it really took Christian Huygens in the 1650s, a Dutch guy, to actually design a clock that you could apply a pendulum to, and it increased clock accuracy by 100-fold, and suddenly clocks could be much more accurate. They could be used for scientific purposes, and also it made a big difference, and it ended up creating, you know, pendulum clocks that could be accurate. This is a typical long case clock, a grandfather clock, like the one that's behind me that I'll talk about a little later. And it turns out that if a pendulum is about a meter long, 3 feet long, it's a royal pendulum that ticks seconds. So the period of oscillation one way and the other is 1 second in each direction. So it makes it very easy to put a seconds hand on a clock face like that, because the clock will tick seconds otherwise. So when we talked about the prestige of having a clock in the tower in certain towns, so this is Old South Church in my town in Andover, with a nice tower clock up in the tower. But inside too, there often are clocks, a gallery clock. The gallery is the front of the balcony, so that the minister knows what time it was, but if any bored person in the congregation turns around, he's going to see them while they're looking at the clock. So, but that stood there, and this was actually made by John Salwin, an important Boston area clockmaker, and it was presented by Mary Ballard, who was obviously one of the ardent supporters of South Church in Andover, and there's even a part of Andover called Ballardvale because of that family. And I've serviced that clock, and inside is sort of a typical time-only single train movement, weight-driven, that's powering that gallery clock in the church. In the next town over, North Andover, it used to be part of Andover, this was the Congregational Church. It's now the Unitarian Church, and they have a Howard clock movement. Yeah, I'll mention that a little bit later too, because Howard was one of the most important Boston area clockmakers, and that's the tower clock movement that's in there. But just as exciting is this guy who was running around talking about the British coming, racing around. He also was in the bell making business later on, and you can see that this is a Paul Revere bell. There are, I believe, probably 100 or more churches around New England that still have Paul Revere bells in them that were cast by his company. This is actually a trade card from Paul Revere and Son, with the indicating that he was casting metals for various purposes, including church bells. So this is Paul Revere later in life, after he got off his horse. He was quite prosperous in his later life, and so this is a nice portrait of him. Earlier on in the early 1770s, he produced this propaganda piece of the Boston Massacre, as it was called. It didn't happen like this, but Paul was interested in inflaming colonial antipathy to the British, who were occupying Boston at that time. In fact, the soldiers, you know, were being pelted by rocks and snowballs, and you know, it's unclear who fired. And in fact, John Adams was the lawyer for the British soldiers, who got them acquitted mostly. But Paul Revere wanted to inflame local sentiment, so he produced this, and he got it out in such a hurry that there are two timepieces here, and this is a close-up of it. There's actually a wall-mounted sundial, which during the daytime with the shadow would show the time, and then in the old brick church next to it was a clock. But Paul rushed this print out, and he got the time wrong by 2 hours of the Boston Massacre. So he had to issue another version of it a couple of weeks later that had the correct time of the Boston Massacre. But either of those prints, if you find an original one of those now, you shouldn't worry about which time it shows, because they each sell for $300,000 or $400,000. So, you know, don't discard the one with the wrong time and wait for the right one to come along. It'll be good to have it. And I've been kind of dancing around what I'm calling these floor-standing clocks, because until this clock song became popular, at the time of the American centennial celebration, they were never called grandfather clocks. If you went back earlier and asked somebody for a grandfather clock, they would have no idea what you were talking about. But this song became popular, and eventually these floor-standing clocks became known as grandfather clocks. This is a view of the centennial. If there was ever within my lifetime, an invention of time machines, time travel. This is probably the first place I would want to go, because it was just, you know, a huge exhibition of all that was, all the advances of Western society, but mostly of American productivity and factories. There were wonderful things there. There were displays of clocks. These are mostly German clocks being imported, but the Waltham Watch Factory also had a wonderful display at the Centennial, which scared the heck out of the Swiss watchmakers, because they didn't realize that Waltham was starting to produce factory-made watches that were way better than the junk that they were exporting to America. So it took them about 20 years, and eventually you got to the point where Swiss watches were actually good, and then they began to supplant the American factories. But the Centennial was a watershed moment, not only for us, but for the Swiss to realize that their ways of making watches had become outdated, and that they were going to lose the battle with us. This is Simon Willard. Probably some of you at least know the name of Willard, Simon Willard and Aaron Willard, as the perhaps preeminent, most famous Boston area clockmakers. So here's an image of him, and here's one of his typical grandfather clocks, I'll call them now, in a Roxbury-style case. That's where the craftsmen were. That's where a lot of the clockmakers were working, adjacent to Boston and Roxbury. So that's an example of the kind of clock that he would do, and the kind of clock that you see in paintings of domestic scenes in New England. So this is called a frolic. It was a kind of a supervised party where people could meet each other and perhaps do some courting. So you see this couple here, the guy's maybe a little unsure of what's gonna happen here, but you see there's a whole party going on, and everybody is part of the celebration. And anybody reading this painting would know that this is a sort of an affluent, sophisticated family that had the money and the desire to have one of these, you know, high-tech timekeeping machines in their house. You can read it that way. And this is the one that you saw in my introductory image. This is by Robert Peckham, who was sort of a better than average folk art painter in early Massachusetts in the 1820s. And this painting is at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and it's showing his family, the Peckham Sawyer family. And at first you think, oh good, here's another party, with again a nice clock in the side there. But this is actually not a party. It's summer, but you see the shutters are shut and people aren't looking that happy. And that's because little Elizabeth had died about 3 months before this painting was done. And this is a common thing where you would create an artwork still showing the deceased person, whether it was an old person or a child, because they were still part of the family, even if physically they weren't there anymore, spiritually they were, and the artist and the family wanted to have a representation of that person still enjoying being with the family. So little Elizabeth had passed, but she lives on in this painting of the Peckham Sawyers. So there was an itinerant clockmaker named Joseph Davis, who would go town to town. We've cut off part of him. I think our projector isn't quite married up to my iPad, but I promise you there's a guy's face there too. And so he would visit people, and you know, in a day or two he would do a nice little portrait of them. These are usually little small watercolors. And whether they actually owned a banjo clock, we don't know, because the artist could say, well, do you want to look like you're rich? You know, we'll put a banjo clock in the picture. And we'll even give you a cat if you want. So I'm not sure if that meant you were rich or not if you had a cat. But definitely if you had a banjo clock, you had enough money to buy a banjo clock. So this is showing that. And banjo clocks often had these paintings in their dials. I don't deal much in my horology and art subject in the artwork that's actually on clocks, but there were these lovely reverse painted, meaning the painting was on the back of the glass and had to be painted in reverse order, that would show patriotic scenes. This was a very typical one from the War of 1812. We're now starting to think about how clockmaking became efficient and enough for the average people to be able to afford clocks, because they were still expensive. Even those Willard banjo and tall clocks, you had to be quite prosperous to own one of those. But a fellow named Eli Terry in the beginning of the 1800s figured out that he could actually mass produce clocks, and this was really the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in America and in New England, because he was able to, with water power, he was able to make clocks and watches, to make clocks using wood to make wood movement clocks. This is Seth Thomas, who was one of his collaborators. This is his first mill, the Ireland Mill, that's in a section of what was then called Plymouth, Connecticut, which is now called Thomaston, named after Seth Thomas, in the 1860s. And one of his first styles was the pillar and scroll clock that you see here. These are some of the earliest American sort of mass-produced clocks. And you see inside that mostly all the gears and parts of the clocks were made out of wood. And it's because wood was available and inexpensive, and brass was not. The British didn't want us to make brass here. You would import it, or if you needed brass for something, you'd try to melt down the old candlestick or some coins maybe to get metal to make brass out of. So we had plenty of wood, and you can see just up there in the escape wheel with little tiny teeth you couldn't make out of wood, but the rest of that is made out of wood, usually cherry and some of those wheels, oak were in some of the other parts of the clock. They knew which woods would not be liable to split or break or swell or shrink as much as others. And these clocks were sold by peddlers. They would go house to house, town to town, selling these clocks. And you see he's got one in the back there. And the way that they did this usually is they would leave the clock there at the farmhouse, you know, with the farm wife, and say, you know, you don't have to buy it now, you have to pay it. Just, you know, see how you like it, and I'll be back in a couple of months. And you knew absolutely once that clock was on the mantle there, that was not leaving the house. You know, even if the cheapskate farm husband, you know, was saying, why do we need this? You know, that was a great sign that you had sort of elevated your status in life and you had enough to afford a nice clock that actually rang on the hours. And also that was a very good marketing technique for those clock peddlers. Chauncey Jerome came along about 20, 30 years later and figured out a way to make inexpensive brassworks clocks, because woodenworks clocks, you know, have disadvantages. Brass would be better if it became cheap enough. And he, one of his first styles was called the OG clock, which is named after sort of the S shape of that molding. And in these, there was always a nice big opening in the clock dial, the clock face. So you could see that you don't have one of those junky old woodenworks clocks. You actually have a brassworks clock, so all your neighbors could see that you've got a new brass clock. And you actually could see the clock work ticking inside there, too, through that opening. And people like to see things moving in clocks. So this, again, was a great leap forward in affordable, reliable American clock making. And eventually, once we figured out how to make mainsprings, because those clocks were weight-driven, weights would hang, and so you needed a pretty big case or some way to have room inside the case for weights to drop. And making mainsprings was tricky. Springs, if they're too brittle, they explode, which is not fun. If they're not strong enough, they won't power the clock. But once we figured out how to do mainsprings, we could make even smaller clocks in huge varieties. And this is a clock that, again, we would recognize as a steeple clock. They weren't called that then. They were called sharp Gothic, because it was a real revival of Gothic architecture and design. So this was along with that. And here's a great horology and art image of a steeple clock. And as you see back then, children were much larger than they are now. or the clocks were smaller, but this is also a great folk art painting that's at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. This artist obviously had a problem with perspective, you know, but I guess the kid was the most important thing anyway. You see the little miniature cat there too. So this is one of my favorites, and you can see the strawberries were huge back then too. Right? They've gotten much smaller in modern times. Following that, you know, again, we were trying to make affordable clocks that were interesting. So these black marble clocks, or black mantle clocks, as they were called, they were imitating more expensive French marble clocks that looked like that. But almost in every house in America, then there'd be clocks like this. They might cost $3, $4, $5, which could be a week's pay, but you didn't need a year's pay to have a clock in the house. And this was the clock. You know, you didn't have one in the microwave and, you know, three in the bedroom. You know, you had a clock in the house that would gong the hours and the half hours sometimes. So this was the clock, and they were very important to family members. So you see in this example, these people are fleeing the Great Fire in Salem, Massachusetts in 1914. And you can see that, you know, one of the few things that she decided to rescue from her house was her black mantle clock. I'm hoping she didn't have three kids, you know, and take the clock instead. But Salem certainly experienced a very bad fire, and if you don't believe me, this is the way Salem looked after that fire. So there isn't much left in that part of town, unfortunately. So again, her clock would have been incinerated, I think, if she had left it behind. But I've become active and a nice part of the Salem Athenaeum. That's a great old membership library in Salem. And I had this clock for many years that I actually bought from under a guy's bed in Salem many years ago. But I knew that it had Salem provenance because the Young Men's Union was an association from about 1850 to 1890 that brought in speakers like me to Salem audiences, but often there'd be 1,500 people at these things. They'd have famous preachers and politicians come and speak to them, and they had concerts. So the Young Men's Union was an important group there, and clearly they had lady friends who thought they were important and nice enough group in order to buy them a clock for their office. So this clock was there, and I just felt like this clock really should be back in Salem, so I donated it to the Salem Athenaeum, and you see me here setting it up and telling a group there about why the clock belonged there, and it's now ticking nicely on the wall of the Salem Athenaeum. So with a great picture of Nathaniel Hawthorne looking over it as well. So timekeeping became increasingly important to railroads too, not just to make sure you didn't miss your train, but to make sure that the trains missed each other. At first, there weren't that many trains going back and forth. You see, this is leaving Boston, 7, so the tracks weren't that crowded, but often it was a single line track, and if a train was coming in the other way, you needed to get off. So you see, it's getting a little busier. The Boston and Maine Railroad now in 1846, starting to get a little more congested, and the schedules got a little bit tighter. You had to worry more about that. This is the Boston and Maine Railroad station in Boston. There was a lot of railroad terminals in Boston that have been knocked down. This had a clock, of course, up in the top of the building. So Boston, Worcester, you see, this is starting to get really busy now with trains going back and forth. And if you weren't careful, this is what happened, where you'd create a lot of expensive scrap metal on the railroad track, because if somebody's timepiece running the train was not accurate enough and they didn't get off on the siding to let the 8:34 go by, they would meet head on. And the railroad companies got kind of sick of this, as did the traveling public. So they needed to do something about it, even though still today there are train wrecks. This is a horrible one that just took place in Greece. I don't think it was because somebody's watch was off by 2 minutes, but trains still crash and they still try to find ways to not have that happen if you can help it. But part of the problem was that up until 1883, there was not standard time. We had more than 700 time zones in America, because everywhere, every locality, noon was when the sun was directly overhead. And it didn't matter when it took you a day to get to Boston from Andover, but it mattered if it took you 20 minutes to get to Boston from Andover on the train, and Andover's time was different than Boston's. So that was it became a nightmare of scheduling, and it led to crashes as well as train schedules that were 3 inches thick, and because noon in Worcester is not noon in Boston, so which time is it? And you would have clocks like this, which show railroad time and local time, and everybody got confused. So finally, in 1883, we had the Day of Two Noons, where standard time, America was divided into four time zones, and everybody got on board, except for all the people that didn't like the fact that somebody in Washington was telling them what time it was. There was a lot of sort of railing by local clergymen, particularly, God put the sun up there, and it's, I don't care what you tell me, Boston and Maine Railroad, it's noon in Worcester. And they fought that for a while, but I think everyone realized the advantages of having standard time as opposed to 700 time zones. So eventually we were able, you see, this is the train station Newton a while ago. They did have double track lines at that point, which cut down a lot on the creation of scrap metal on the side of the road. But they needed to have very accurate timepieces. And Waltham was one of the companies down the road that made railroad grade watches. And I'm not just talking about a watch that has a little train scratched on the back. You know, these actually had very serious mechanical advantages, which allowed the timekeeping to be extremely accurate, which it needed to be. And if you were a conductor or an engineer on a train, you needed to actually carry a piece of paper that talked, that gave the service history of your watch, how it had to be inspected every 2 weeks, had to be serviced every 6 months, and the inspector would take the watch away if you weren't up to date on that. So they had the most important watchmakers of the factory would take these watches after they were manufactured and do additional adjusting on them to keep them going. These have these up-down indicators which tell you if the clock is wound or unwound, because you certainly don't want to forget to wind your watch if you're pulling 500 freight cars behind you. So those Waltham watches and railroad grade watches are still quite collectible today, people, because they were sort of the epitome of mechanical genius, ingenuity that's so tiny, but you can have a machine that keeps time within seconds a week. You know, good luck with anything else, you know, being that accurate. So it was sort of an amazing feat, but it was necessary, really, to make the trains safe. There's an early view of the Waltham Watch Factory. That building is still there, you may know. It's much bigger. It got bigger. Waltham made 38 million watches. So if you have a Waltham watch and you think it's, you know, the Magna Carta, it's probably not. Even if it's a Waltham railroad-grade watch, they made a lot of them. But again, the building's there. They have a nice little museum on the first floor where you can get a nice history of that Waltham Watch Company. But what really saved the Waltham Watch Company, they were started in the 1850s, but they were struggling to make watches that people would want to buy and that they could afford. But the Civil War came along when soldiers, regular soldiers, could afford to have watches. And it was one of the first armed conflicts where people were very much aware of what the time was, and even average soldiers could carry watches like this. And when they had watches, they were proud of them. And this fellow obviously had his picture taken and probably sent home so they could see that he was in uniform and had a nice watch to go with it. This is one of those watches. This is a Waltham Model 57 designed in that year. And this is what they would have looked like when they were carried around. This is a Waltham watch from a little bit later, but this one was owned by an important person. So the Theodore Roosevelt watch, pocket watch, is coming up for auction next week. The auction estimate is only 100 to 200,000. So I'm sure all of you will be rushing to your computers to place left bids now that you know that you could own Teddy Roosevelt's pocket watch. But it's accompanied by paperwork too, where he's written letters to his family members that gave him the watch saying, this is great, you know, I'm so happy to have this. There's mentions of this watch when he's down in the Amazon after he was president, where he still has this watch and he's using it. So it's an important piece of watch history. If it didn't belong to Teddy Roosevelt, it would be about a $200 watch, right? But I guess there's a few multiples involved when you have an association antique like that. And this is a view of the watch factory itself. The 1893, these views of the factory were made, and you can see that it's all women working there. This was a wonderful place for women to work. If they were doing the same job as men, they were paid the same. It was bright and airy. It had to be clean if you're making watches. And you know, they were particularly suited to doing this kind of intricate work. Of course, the boss was a guy standing there cracking the whip, but when they were at work there, mostly it was women. And this is a great image too, because you see there's a clock on the wall behind them showing it. So as we talk about where else you can see clocks around here, there's this great down in Bristol, Connecticut, the American Clock and Watch Museum, where you can see hundreds of American clocks. This is one of their galleries showing the display. It's a nice day trip down to Bristol to see that. Old Sturbridge Village not only has a clock with a clock and a steeple, but it has a wonderful gallery of a couple of hundred American clocks on display there. The Willard House Clock Museum, the birthplace of those Willards I was talking about. It's the original homestead. It's still there. It's now a house museum that has more Willard clocks than anywhere else in the world in one place. It's in Grafton, right near Worcester. Again, another great field trip. And they have the only clock workshop still on its original site. because that's where they started working, and that building is still there, and they've done a recreation of the clockmaker's shop right in the same site. The Concord Museum, as you know, is right down the road, and they have a nice clock collection there too. I had hoped that David Wood, their curator, was gonna come today, but guess he had some gardening to do, so he's not here, but there's a picture of him. So David Wood actually is able to travel back in time. So, so you know, he was actually in the American Revolution, but he forgot to put on his old-style clothing, so he really stood out as somebody from another time period. But anyway, if he'd been here, he would have laughed, I hope, with that picture of him too. But they have some great clocks, including this sort of rare version of a banjo clock called the Diamond Head Banjo Clock, made right in Concord. And like a lot of rare clocks, the reason they're rare is because nobody liked them. So, and to me, you know, this is an ugly version of a banjo clock, and I guess most people agreed with me because they didn't make or sell many of them, but at least they were able to have one that survived that's over there in the museum. So now let's look at some watches that are in the collection here, because I always try to ask historical societies in particular if they have clocks and watches in their collection, and then I can help them know what they have. And so they sent me pictures, but apparently whoever had cataloged these before did not know about how to open a watch to sort of see what the movement was and find out who the actual maker was. So I was able to go with Carol earlier, and I was able to open the watches and make some notes for them and take some pictures for them of what's inside those watches. So there's the back of it too, C18. I don't think the maker put that on there. But what's inside is a movement that looks like this. I wanted to include a picture of an early, these are 18th century English watches. And I was able to see that one was made by Thomas Hall, and another was made by a guy named Parkinson. And I'll provide them with more information after I find them in the book. I did look in my book, which I brought along here, and the interesting thing too is that there is a Thomas Parkinson who made watches in Bedford, England. So that is kind of a nice coincidence. I don't think it has anything to do with the watches that are here, but it's an interesting coincidence. And those watches have a different system too of ticking inside called a verge escapement. And the thing that's actually ticking, they're sort of vertical like this, so it means the watch has to be pretty fat to fit in those things. Later watches could be skinnier because you didn't have to have vertical wheels like this that weren't parallel to the thing that was actually ticking back and forth. And there's another view of just some watch work where you see this wheel, this crown wheel, had to be vertical, so the watch had to be fairly fat in order to fit that in. And those watches also had a thing called a fusee inside, because the watches were run by mainsprings, and typically when you wind up a spring, it's stronger than when it's running down. So you needed some kind of gear, if you cared, to make the clock, to sort of equalize that power. So this would have this would be attached. You see, this is actually a picture of a watch with a tiny little fusee, and there was a tiny little chain that was like the world's smallest bicycle chain that children in England used to make, usually poorhouse orphan children, like the little guy over there. He'd be making these fusee watches, fusee chains, and that's what connected the fusee to the mainspring and allowed the power to travel through. So, and the fusee, it's sort of like a 10-speed bike, you know, your derailleur's on the back. It's just sort of changing the gears so that as the spring is strong, it doesn't make the clock run fast, and when it's getting weaker, winding down, it doesn't make the clock run, or the watch run slowly. So, and there's a diagram of it too, showing how this, there's the chain and the barrel, the spring would be inside there, very strong, but it would be changing the power that then was being transmitted through the rest of the system. And if you really want to know how these really work, Richard will tell you everything that I've said wrong. Ever made a fusee chain, Richard?
I've prepared a couple, but I've never made one.
I see. That's why your hair is gray, though, right? From even repairing them. Yeah, that's out of my skill set. But there's another view of how this would look. And like the watches, one of the watches that's down there, these are in silver cases, and the British had assay offices to ensure that the silver was really silver. So they would mark them with hallmarks that confirmed that they were silver, say who the casemaker was, say what city the assay office was in. So, and I was able to take a picture of those of the watches that belonged to this group, and I will identify those hallmarks for them. And that if the movement is original to the case, which I believe it is, that will tell you the exact year the watch was made. So you can date it to the year, which was nice. So this is another picture of the watch that they have down there. And the nice thing about this is that inside, I believe both of these watches are watch papers. These were little paper discs that were printed and had the watchmaker's name on it. So he probably either sold this watch and or repaired it later on, and he'd put his little watch paper in there. And these are great if you still have them. People collect watch papers. If they're out, not in a watch anymore, you can spend $100, $200 on a watch paper, which is why I don't own too many watch papers. But they're great to find in there. And sometimes there's stacks of them. You know, each time somebody worked on it, he'd put his watch paper in there. So you can carefully kind of lift it and see if there's another one underneath. So I was able to find this guy, Andrew Trott. So there you see again the watch paper inside a pair case. These are called pair cases because there's really a pair of cases. There's an outer case and an inner case that it sits in. And there's our guy, Trott, Andrew Trott, and it gives the years that he was born and died and where he worked from my reference book. So, you know, that's great when you have a watch paper because you know at least at some point this guy worked on that watch. That watch was in his hands. And this is even better because this is inside the other watch. Joseph Dyer's watch paper is inside there. And you see he has a much bigger entry. I'm sorry, it's blurry down there. But he was important because he was in Concord and he was working with other clockmakers to make important clocks like this Lyre clock here. This is L-Y-R-E, this shape of clock that was a beautiful adaptation of a New England banjo clock. The other watch down there is junky, and I was trying to be kind about it. But it's a Swiss watch, unsigned. It just says that it's a cylinder escapement is on the back. These are all key wind watches, by the way. You need a little key to wind them. These don't have much value, and they're sort of an example of the junkier Swiss watches that were coming here and trying to compete with Waltham that were making really good watches. They were cheap, but they were cheap because two out of three of them never worked. So that was not a good thing. So let's look at your clock that you have here, which is now standing in the back here by Barlow. I was happy to have this write-up and this picture of the clock. And you notice that whoever wrote this up, whether it was last year or a few years ago, I'm not sure when, noted that Barlow, you know, ancestors was the inventor of the repeating clocks. And I thought, this is great. You know, they have an important clock here. Wrong. This is not the same Barlow family. So I suppose at some point you'll need to fire your cataloger and note that this Barlow is not the Barlow connected with creating sort of an advance in watch and clock making, repeating, which is actually if you press a little button or pull a little string, the clock will ring the previous hours. So if it's dark, for example, you can press a little button on your watch, and if it's 10 after 5, it'll ding, ding 5 times. So you know that it's sometime between 5 and 6. But this clock does not do that, and this Barlow is not that Barlow. So again, I always hate to bring bad news to places, but I don't think it's terrible news, so I didn't feel bad about it. But this is actually the Barlow who made this clock from my reference book. This is a James Barlow that was active in England, and in the same area where the other Barlow worked, but again, not the same guy. And here in one of my reference books, too, it's showing a clock by William Barlow, who is the brother of your James, and interestingly showing the same shape of moon dial in the dial, which is unusual. Most typically the moon indication is up in an arch above the square dial. So to have the moon phase indicator sort of underneath the 12 is unusual and interesting, and that sort of makes this clock special for that reason. that the Barlows had this other way of showing the lunar cycle on the faces of their clocks. So you also, and I was able to see this downstairs, you have a Howard Master Clock, they're called, which has a paper tape inside that would go through pulleys once a week and had a little electrical contacts, so it would ring the bells in a factory or a school. So it's great that that you have one of those master clocks there. It would also send a signal to the secondary clocks that were around the school or the building, telling them every minute, you know, to advance a minute. And some of you may be old enough to remember in school how, you know, you'd watch that clock and eventually it would move ahead a minute in the classroom, and that's because it was getting a signal from the master clock. But did you ever notice how those clocks, like it took them 5 minutes to move 1 minute when you were in class at 5 minutes to two? Yeah, so they somehow they worked these master clocks to slow way down in the afternoon. But anyway, so we don't have those anymore. We have nice battery clocks now. So there's a cover of a Howard Clock Company catalog, and you see, you know, that they were very proud of the fact that they made these kinds of commercial level clocks for banks and schools and watchmakers. There's a view of the Howard factory. It's now no longer there in Boston, sadly. And this is from that catalog showing, you know, again, a kind of master clock and all the places where they've placed their clocks over time. One of their competitors was the Standard Electric Time Company. And I used to have one of these clunkers on my wall too. These were nice because they self-wound, because again, if this was running the whole factory clock system and the bells, they didn't want it to stop. So it was an electrical winding system, so every minute you'd hear it kind of go clunk, clunk, and it was winding itself back up again. I took a picture of this in this place because it was down in the cellar of Castle Hill out there in Ipswich. So this was the master clock you just saw for this mansion overlooking Crane Beach there. And there's the factory view of this master clock system, telling you the different systems you could apply to it. Have these little clocks inside that told you what time it was saying in other places. And there's another view showing these clocks that would, you know, tell you what time it said in the various factories, and there's an external tape unit where the paper tape would run through and do the bell ringing around the place. So the final picture of a clock that's owned by the Historical Society here is I'm showing you this now too, and this could easily go in your next yard sale. That would be fine. These were quite common, but you see that this was the Tambor number 3 made by Seth Thomas in 1921, and they just made gazillions of these. You know, these were the common household clock in this tambour shape that became very, very popular. So, yeah, I mean, it's nice that you have an example, but it doesn't, I don't think it has any particular significance to this town or to clock-making history. So my final, almost semi-final image is another horology and art piece, and you might, this is great, Bob, but where's the clock? Where's the watch? But at first we're gonna, I'll tell you that this is Mount Mansfield, which is the tallest mountain in Vermont. And this is a painting from 1850 showing a party of people that have gotten to the top of Mount Mansfield, but you can see that it's already starting to get a little dark. And this fellow is holding his watch up and reminding them that if they don't want to go down the mountain at night, they should probably be moving along. So this is my cue to say that I've taken your time up so far now, and I'm holding my watch up to say I'm done, but I'm happy to look at some clocks that people have brought and also to take any questions before we wrap things up. I know it's between me and the cookies at this point, but if you want to ask a few questions, or we can I can just look at things over there, I'm happy to do it. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, you know, I think I should just take that out of here and take it home. It really doesn't belong here. Yeah. It's, yes, I did see a picture of this too, and I was wondering where it was. Yes, yeah, so this is this has many good reasons for why it's a good clock. Howard and Davis was the predecessor to the Howard Clock Company. He had a partner for a while. And they also made bicycles and they made postal scales as well. And this is, for obvious reasons, called the marble front clock. Just the front of it is a very, as well. And this is for obvious reasons, called a marble front clock. It's all in gallery clock that I showed you that's in South Church. So that's what's powering it. I would be able to show this in a nice catalog too. I've serviced a couple of these, and believe me, that piece of marble is heavy, and you can't service the clock without removing it. You've probably almost been crushed a couple of times by a marble front clock, but that's a lovely example, and I'm happy to see it now that the screen is up, because that's a great piece too. And it's great, you know, often the people who gave these clocks want to be remembered. This is the way they did it. I've serviced a number of clocks from Phillips Andover Academy that's in my town, and a lot of those also have. The donor name. I was getting a bad look because I wasn't near the microphone. So those also have the donor names on them. So that's really a wonderful piece. So I'm glad to see that as well. Let's see, anybody else raise their hand? Are you dying for the cookies? Yes, sir. Yeah, I think you're asking were the Swiss making watches. Yes, later on they were, because the Swiss. I mean, I was a little cavalier that the Swiss also could and did make beautiful watches and high grade watches too. It's just the ones that they were making for export and to sell to people that didn't know any better were lousy. But yes, they made high, not clocks, you know, Switzerland was not a place for clock manufacturing particularly. European clocks were made in the Black Forest in Germany and other parts of Germany and in France and in England. But the Swiss mostly had these cottage industries where during the winter when they couldn't be farming, they would have their little workshops, and often they would make single or just a couple of parts which they would provide to the finisher who would put the whole watch together and then put his name on it and sell it in that way. So, anybody else? Yes, in the back.
This is not really a question. It's just, it made me think of something interesting when you said, like, you'd be staring at the clocks in the school that were all synced up. Well, interestingly enough, the clocks in the high school work the same way, but, like, there'll be these clocks that would, like, jump 5 seconds at a time, and there's one that, like, jumps 2 seconds at a time. And whenever it's daylight savings time, they have to change the master clock. And so, for some reason, when they reset it, they like wind all the clocks like all the way back. So like all the clocks, but like they don't just do like 1 hour. So you just see the clock like going around in a circle and like and you're like what? So yeah, that just reminded me of that. It's kind of
Yes. Yeah, that's good. And do you realize, too, that when that clock goes backwards, you actually, your life gets longer? Yeah. Yeah. Yes. That was the watches. They were watches, luminous dials, and yes, and they would, yeah, there's even a play and a book about the radium girls like that. Yes, because they were, and there are still watches around, you know, collector watches where if you put them near a Geiger counter, you know, you peg the needle. Because the radium, you know, is luminous. They found that there were other things that don't kill you that also are luminous. But they were pointing the brushes with their tongues and then painting the numerals. Yeah, I have other talks. I have pictures of those young women lined up in their factory rooms, you know, all painting those numbers on. Yeah, it was a tragic story. And of, you know, typically the business and factory owner said, oh, you know, that's perfectly harmless. They're getting jaw cancer for some, you know, if they're eating too much gum, chewing too much gum or something. So. Yeah, it's a bad part of watchmaking history for sure. So, all right, I guess I've worn you out. Thank you again. Let me go look.
We'll call the formal meeting adjourned, but stay around and and take part in the festivities to look at clocks if you wish.
This kind of clock is called a cottage clock, and these again were sort of, you know, almost the cheapest clock you could get because it was nice and small. But you see, it's a this one does strike the hours. It has two winding holes, but you can see because the holes are way up high, it has a small movement that needed to be wound every day. They're called 30-hour clocks, which is how you describe a daily wind clock. If it's an 8-day clock, that means weekly wind, and the movement would have been bigger, which would have meant the winding holes would be lower down. So this has some authentic paper packing in here, too. And you always want to transport the clock with the pendulum off, and then you don't have to jam paper inside. And this also allows us to see the paper label inside, which is still intact, and mostly they are, and it's great to see it. So this is Jerome and Company, Chauncey Jerome. You saw his picture. He invented a cheap way to make brass movement clocks. Eventually, Jerome clocks were bought by New Haven Clock Company. So this is probably from that era. It's definitely made in New Haven. But this is sort of in nice condition. The glass still, this is the original reverse painted glass, which is in good condition too. And often these veneers on here start popping off, but this case is in very nice condition too. But it's still, these are common clocks, so this still would only be $100, $150 clock if it sold at auction. But it's a nice example of what it is, and mostly in good original condition as well. This also is an alarm clock. Whenever you see the brass disc here, you could set the alarm using this disc, and this is the little alarm mechanism inside, that if you also wound that up, when it got to 8 o'clock, if you set the alarm for 8 o'clock, it would ring like crazy until it ran down. You couldn't shut it off. So it made sure you were awake in that time period. So it would do that, but much faster and much louder until it ran out of gas. So this was kind of the top of the line of a cottage clock because it was time and strike and had an alarm. So it was probably $4 instead of $3.40. Yeah. So, but again, it's a nice example. So I'm happy to see this too.